From 1927 to 1941, nearly 400 men worked on the mountain or with support crews on the premises. For most workers, it started out as just a job.
1928, my brother and I was getting out timber down at the mine, and they wanted somebody to come up and get timbers out for a studio they were going to build. So we come up, got out this timbers, got everything all ready for the studio, and then we went up on the mountain, and that's how I landed here.
First, there was the matter of reaching carvable granite, dynamiting away excess stone.
These guys that were using the dynamite, they had used it a lot, and especially this one old fella. But when you got up there where you were just blasting around the shaft scaffolds and stuff, and you didn't want to take them down, and they would take that round dynamite and wrap and put a electric cap in it and then tie it, and the holes were always tamped with sand so that the full force. This one fellow was so good, he could set them charges off and never hit a thing.
To set dynamite charges and for other tasks, workers were hoisted over the cliff in sling seats.
Going down was never a problem because you were just going along, and as the cable went out, you had to go or else. But I'll tell you, when you tried to come back up at first, you didn't trust that cable. You just didn't think, and you, instead of rearing back and getting your feet rigid like they should be, you had a tendency to lean forward, and if you didn't watch it, pretty soon they'd have you right on your face, just dragging you right up there.
The positions that you had to get in if you're drilling out of a harness, you couldn't, the jackhammer would tend to kick you away from the rock all the time, and you had to compensate for that some way. Sometimes we'd take a chain and tie ourselves into the rock so we could hold ourselves solid enough. Like I would try to do, get a roll hole started, and then I could hook one leg over and stand a straddle of the thing to make the next hole and just go right on down the row of holes there with it, you know. Run the hammer, I could get some weight of my body on there instead of just my hands.
Those winters were terrific. A cold man, you know, that. I'd put on a pair of silk socks, a pair of wool socks, and then felt boots and a pair of rubbers over there to keep your feet warm, so it wasn't very comfortable up there.
Carvers reached the sculpture's final surface by drilling a pattern of holes to the desired depth. This was called honeycombing because of the look of the stone during the process. Finally, a four-star drill bit bumped the surface smooth.
Not all of the workmen, of course, cut and blasted stone. Other specialists operated a regular village here, compressor house, blacksmith shop, hoist house. And workman Glenn Bradford remembers building scaffolding on the faces.
Well, when I went up there, they didn't have much scaffolding. And so the drillers drilled in all about 8 feet apart and put these here long drill steel, what it was. And then they'd let down the planks, and we'd fasten them to these steel pins that were sticking out there, and then we'd brace under there so that it wouldn't all fall down. And then after we got that done, we'd put up another set of them.
Many of the men rode up to the job on the tramway in a little wooden cage that traveled on a quarter mile long cable slanting steeply from here to the top of the mountain. The most serious accident of the entire project occurred on the day when a mechanical failure caused that cage to break loose and come hurtling back down that cable toward the hoist house. Happy Anderson was injured in that accident and remembers it well.
We were coming down pretty good speed, then the one boy, he going to help out the guy on the brake, and he grabs a hold of the chain too, and he towed his 220 pounds on it, and he busted the handle off. Well, after that, I was just freewheeling till Matt Riley took a drill steel that was sitting there. He slammed it through them drive wheels there. How he ever got that through there, I don't know, without getting his head knocked off. Well, all the time we was coming down there, and I'd thought of it before, if anything ever happened and that thing broke loose and we come back down there. Compressor house was right below there where we landed with that. And I figured I'd jump out of that thing and hit that roof. And it was on an angle, and I figured I'd probably break a leg and pick up a lot of splinters, but it'd be a lot better than slapping up against that rock. And to this day, I don't know whether I jumped or fell out of that thing. If I jumped, I didn't figure out my speed quite right. I slapped up against the rock.